This is a talk on Indian design history. Indian design history. So even one at a time, these words are among the most tendentious and vast words that you can find. And together, they are impossibly daunting. What is Indian about how we live and think and define ourselves? What is design and what isn't? And how does it differ from art and craft? Finally, if it's a history, every history struggles with validating its own particular selection of facts. So to simplify this, I'm going to frame design as we practice it today as professionals, as it is today, as designers. It will have Suchitra calls an institutional character in that it's about companies, governments, and colleges. These would be the players. Now, design as a human activity obviously predates designers by thousands of years, since the label designer is best placed perhaps in the second half of the 20th century, and that's as a outcome of professional and educational specialization of a kind. For this evening, I propose that we qualify this practice of design with these characteristics, and here's what I propose. My motto. The first one is purpose. Design has a purpose or a goal, and that's it's a fundamental province of design. So when you study design, this is the first thing you're told. And this is particularly true if you think of design as things. And the purpose of design can be it can be functional, it can be experiential, or it can be indeed symbolic. We design a teapot, so we say, to be easier to lift or pour from or wash out or maybe transport from the factory to the store and from the store to the home, or simply to just warm our sense of what it is to, what does tea mean to us? So just to warm our heart sense of what tea might mean to you, you might design a teapot for that, for none of the functional reasons. But of course, design is about thinking that leads to making things. And so the role of a designer involves a separation of separation of making and thinking about making. So the idea that there would be two distinct roles, that there'd be maybe a person himself may be doing both the roles, but they're distinct roles, usually by two separate people. Somebody is thinking about making it, and then somebody else, or by another process, the thing itself is getting made. Another criterion I'd like to introduce is that of reproducibility. In other words, that there is a recurring, repeating reason for which both the demand and the supply can be reproduced. In other words, we assume that somebody needs the same thing repeatedly, and then somebody can provide the same thing repeatedly. So this concept of reproducibility, I would propose, is one that distinguishes our practice today. So if you put these together, what you see in this notion is, you see a notion of a plan, or maybe a template, or maybe a tool, or maybe a mold. It could be a printing plate, it could be a die. It could be a drawing. Finally, it's a means of organizing profession. And in this sense, I'm going to call upon a cheerfully circular definition of design that I like, which defines design as designing a design to make a design. The last criterion I think of is that a work of design has some kind of individuality, some kind of identity. You identify something as a designed work. Just about 10 minutes ago, we were having a discussion on whether JNU was a well-designed campus, and one of my friends said, I'm not sure it's designed exactly. So this is also a sense in which the word designed is used. So there is an individuality, an identity, a sense of authorship to that. And if you're continuing down the teapots theme, then one could look at a design classic, which is referred to the 934 from Alesi. Perhaps it was the 934th attempt to get it right or whatever. It's a design classic, and these, I think, represent the entire design process from the sense of its functional or its experiential or its symbolic role, and the way that it is indeed turned into a mass-produced object which is durable and which continues to be sought after by lots of people maybe 10 years after it was made. It had an incredibly long life, and you can still buy them for lots and lots of money. It remains now to point out what the lenses are for this kind of a history. And these are the lenses, it's the best way I can describe it, through which I see this activity progressing. As a professional label, design is very young. So if what we'll be looking at today are two or three tracks. And the first one is design education. And this is, you know, the teaching of design at institutes which are devoted to this task. They have shaped both the theory and the practice of, you know, how we practice design. These are the places everywhere in the world where design was defined, where it is defined, it's debated, evangelized, and the fort is defended. And design's victories are recorded, you know, with great fervor, and its losses are mourned and cried over. But the practice of design itself, once the education is done at an institute, the real education starts, and that is about economics, and which dictates the sort of commercial exchange that the profession implies. What is eventually an exchange of value between two people. In India, the economy, I believe, has been defined by the presence of the government or the state, or the relative vacation of state from the economy in whichever sector you're looking at it. And so issues of development will always be important. 20th century India's, maybe 20th century world, is about things like development, industrialization, ideas like modernity, which are also linked with these. And so it's natural that Indian design's engaging with tradition is, or choosing not to engage or turning its back on tradition, in the way in which it does kind of a deal between these, you know, negotiates it, as they say, these will obviously be a concern of ours. I'm going to introduce a timeline. This framing leads to a timeline based on what is convenient to divide it into a few kind of periods based on things that I think are watershed events. And the first of these is the road all the way up to independence. Then there is from independence till 1961, a mysterious year when I was 1 year old, and I'll tell you the significance of that, apart from my being 1 year old. And then up to 91 when I turned 31. And then from 91 to the present day. I'm 54. So let's take up the first of these, and the first of these is what I'm calling the road to independence, and this is about the colonial era in which much of business activity and the formation, the concept of design was being formed in education and in practice, and it tended to mirror the beliefs and attitudes that held sway in England at the time, and that influence was exerted on India by means of various arms of the British state. Now, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. Government colleges of art have always been around, and this one is the JJ School of Art, the Sir JJ School of Art. Now, Sir JJ's agenda was economic, and his was an effort to improve the aesthetic or decorative standard of craft in the manufacture of objects. Now, in 1850s India, manufacture meant made by hand, which is the root sense of the word manufacture. You know, manus means hand. And it saw the European tradition of academic training as a very useful building block towards this. And this was the view of design's role that prevailed in England at the time, so as an applied and therefore perhaps as an inferior kind of cousin of art. So something like art is good and design is maybe not so good. In the visual arts, these same colleges that have been around, they tried to overwrite the kind of art that was traditional in India, mainly the art taught by the princely courts, and they tried to overwrite this with instruction in superior, if you like, academic traditions. Things like teaching perspective or teaching a realistic study of light and shade. And this turned out a lot of artists who were able to supply artworks which met the market for information and the fascination with India, information about India. And this dominance of this education over whatever was our heritage seems to be quite complete, because we seem to have very eagerly accepted it. And it was so eagerly accepted that, well, this is a picture of E.B. Havel, who was a very sympathetic art administrator, and he was sympathetic to Indian art, and he took over from at the Government College of Art in Calcutta from Madras, and he tried to introduce a system of art education which pointed more back to our Indian heritage, and it led to that most Bengali of reactions, which was a strike. And students were very keen to protect their future livelihood. Now, much of that livelihood might have come for these students from a newly formed profession, just nascent profession called advertising. And in the absence of any kind of the word, you know, professional design in the sense that we practice it today as a more or less horizontal competency, advertising gives a good clue to the design sensibility of the time. Now, the overarching influence of the colonial economy, you know, is characterized by relatively few local manufacturers and a lot of import. And so in advertising, Western manufacturers attempted to compete for Indian customers, often with Japanese exports, for example. Their imagery mixed all kinds of religious depictions, maharajas, westernized gentlemen, western kinds of lettering traditions, and all of these sold products and sat cheerfully on matchbox labels, and there was no real, no trend beyond this. This academic tradition, even in the way it was popularized by Raja Ravi Verma's mythologicals, they're also one strand of this kind of concern or this kind of aesthetic. For the newer and progressive businesses, the design codes tended to, must have tried to hew more strictly to a pakka British kind of style. And here's a bath soap from a much beloved soap manufacturer, very much around today. That's Godrej. And what is it now? This is maybe 50 years before Synthol or something. And as you can see, the kind of freely mixed styles that there were, some brands that you recognize and some that you perhaps don't. By 1905, this is surprisingly old, by 1905 the first advertising agency had been formed. That's an error on the slide over there. By 1905, the first advertising agency was Dattaram's Advertising in Bombay. It still exists. And by 1924 in Calcutta, the National Advertising Agency had been formed. Sir J.J. School of Art introduced a commercial art department by about 1946. And it approached design from the point of view of art rather than from the sciences. And it was a sort of allowable dilution of a very high ideal. That's not a commercial arts class necessary, but this is very much the kind of tradition. It was very much a tradition based on painting and based on learning the decorative arts. But this is not to knock JJ. These are also the decades in which many of Indian contemporary art's most important figures studied at the JJ. The Bombay progressives, you know, Hussain, Raza, Padamsi, Gaitonde, Tayyab Mehta, these people studied here. Same time. So perhaps it takes a non-progressive curriculum to produce progressive painters. But there was a more spirited challenge around the corner, and that was in the form of Tagore's Shantiniketan and Kala Bhavan, which fostered an entirely new and original expression based on Indian art traditions, and where it looked beyond India, it tended to look east to Japan or China. And Kala Bhavan is, of course, the birthplace of the Bengal school with its own galaxy of greats, both among the gurus and among students. In 1921, Tagore appears to have visited the Bauhaus in Weimar, though Suchitra informed me there's some doubt about whether he did so. But he did meet Paul Klee, and he met Kandinsky, and he invited them to send an exhibition to India, and they did. And the Bauhaus exhibit showed at the Indian Oriental Society in 1922. But it was an exhibition of paintings. Maybe if this meeting had taken place in 1930, this might have been different. Bauhaus was very much in the time when it was still settling down. So out of this, in 22 came the Shilpa Sadan, which is the what they called the Institute of Craft and Design at Shriniketan, aimed at promoting crafts and design education to uplift craft and craftsmen. So the agenda was very much about doing something for the rural economy. This is a theme that we'll visit again. And that idea was that in turn would inform the progressive institutions at Shantiniketan. So they would inform each other, they're like a twin project. And Tagore, along with Gandhi, of course, resisted the industrial impulse, both spiritually, aesthetically, politically, economically, in every way. And they also saw craft as an act of creation and, you know, something very noble as an act in itself. There they are, surely agreeing on whatever they are saying. Kala Bhavan, I couldn't gather if it did open a commercial art department during these years, but it did produce Satyajit Rai, who was a brilliant graphic designer in the modern sense, and the third generation of a family of illustrators, at least a third generation. And I'm going to illustrate this with showing you some drawings of his grandfather and then his father and then finally Satyajit. So here's a drawing from Tuni Tuni Boi, the Tailor Birds book about 1912 by Satyajit's grandfather, Upendra Kishore. And you can see the drawing is somewhat idiosyncratic. You'll see that the rendering style is not that different from what you might have expected to find among a pen and ink illustrator fairly contemporaneously in England at the time. So now, Satyajit Ray himself counted his grandfather's drawing as counted him the best illustrator of the three, counted him better than his father, who was also very well known for his illustrations. Now, I'm going to show you some of his father's work. This is Shukumar Rai, and Shukumar Rai's drawing was not rated as highly by his son, but I find them wonderful. I find them these fantastical creatures and a developing kind of very wacky, particularly Bengali kind of idiosyncrasy to them, and I find them completely crazy and quite wonderful. Upendra Kishore, that is the grandfather, founded a magazine, children's magazine called Shondesh, which is, of course, refers to both the sweet thing and something you can read. So he seems to have started this he ran it for a while, and then it shut down. And then I think the press was bought over by somebody else, and he ran it for a while, and then it shut down again. So these are some of the very first kind of issues, and these are a little bit later in the era of color printing. So it shows a very confident, very playful, and I would say very modern engagement with Indian tradition in an utterly feasible and effortless way. I think perhaps his maybe his days as an illustrator in an advertising agency served him very well. If you look at the approach to the lettering, Shondesh, it's on that flag. There was no fixed masthead kind of thing, and this integrated into the illustration in a very delightful way. So I'm just going to show you some of them. The lettering is really getting bolder and bolder, and here's now if you can see the approach to the lettering of Shondesh, which is kind of rising vertically, the way in which it resembles a one of the playing cards, and the way the king himself is treated. So there is a beautiful interplay of what you might call a way of thinking that's in some way Western and some way not. And that's quite remarkable. The king is, by the way, reading Shondesh, which is also a theme you'll find in a couple of his illustrations. Just in time. E.T., perhaps. Satyajit Ray's film posters also obviously very famous, and I think these are incredibly modern conceptions. In particular, the poster for Nayak on the right, as well as the lettering for Debi, which I think is a classic, and I think it had quite an influence on other film titling in Bengali over the years. This is something for which I would like to acknowledge the RAR design blog run by the designers Anamika and Shubho in Shantiniketan, who are the source of much of this. Now, alongside, this was not an entirely bleak scenario for Indian design, because a very unsung exception is in the craft and the manufacture of type. We are talking about letterpress type, the kind that has relief and is set by hand. And this is a relative, it's a sophisticated process. It takes a lot of precision to do, and it's a work of skill. It's a work of design. And again, this is probably because of the demand from Indian language publishing. And by 1850, it's already quite well established. Firms like Nirnay Sagar, which produced the hugely influential Devanagari type, though it has to be said that the science and art of typeface design was not on the agenda of design schools till at least 1960. Yet anonymous designers in these foundries provided both type and all manner of ready-to-use blocks with the popular illustrations of the day. So this... can see a very, I'm just going to go over that. Quite inventive. The Gujarati type foundry also did Latin type, and they tried to meet the need for display types for advertising. Some of it quite original. These images, thanks to Sarang Kulkarni of White Crow, very interesting company that does good work in regional languages. So, in sum, we might say that the overcoming of the colonial yoke in a visual sense as well is just something begun to start. We begin to see resistance to the idea of the way in which design was thought about. And we see some engagement with and resistance to also the industrial and the educational mores of the West. We see a dual engagement with both with tradition and how tradition might fit into a modern India, but that would be this more the subject of the next part of the history, which starts from 1947, and I'm just calling that in a hurry, because that's where I think that India really was in a hurry. So this is the part from 1947 to 1961. And here's an empty timeline of that period. I'm just going to fill that up. There will be no visuals in this part. The period following independence sees the government becoming a very propulsive and perhaps molding force in design, taking the story of design forward at quite a pace. So if the last chapter is all about Bombay, Calcutta and Madras, then in this chapter the action moves to Delhi, not because business or industry shifted, for once, but because of the role of the government, particularly under Nehru. So there's Panditji. Through the 1950s under Nehru and right up to about 1990, we see certain processes starting off that are still in place today. So Nehru had a dual thrust on industrialization and agriculture and technology, but also on small industries and craft. So he was interested in both of these things. And Suchitra Balasubramaniam sees this as a reconciliation of two poles of thought, so modernity and industry-led growth on one end, and the whole India's heritage at the other end via the rejuvenation of craft and craftsmen. A much richer treatment of this process can be found in her doctoral dissertation, which I encourage you to persuade her to share with you. The detailed linkages between the actors involved at this time. Now, the first of these processes was a thrust to help craftsmen and crafts through both acts of parliament and through institutions. Two remarkable women figure in this story. The first of these is Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, who was instrumental in setting up the All India Handicrafts Board in 1952, and a little later the Handloom Board. And Pupul Jaikar is the second of these ladies. These two women who worked separately and in concert. Pupul Jaikar is associated with the setting up of the Weaver Service Center in Chennai. So Pupul Jaikar became, of course, in the coming decades, broadly influential in not just in design but in culture more widely. The name Zarina used to go whenever you said Pupul Jaikar, you had to have the word Zarina in the same sentence if you were in the press. This is an interesting time. The Handloom Board invited artists to rope in improve the standard of fabrics to make them more marketable. And K.G. Subramaniam, who was to become a very important artist in the coming decades, was one of them. He joined as deputy director in brackets design in 1959. Perhaps this is the first designation in India with the word design in it. I'm not sure about this, but it's a nice story. By 1959, this year that we are talking about, a great deal more had happened. And the National Museum had been founded, as had the academies, spelt with a K, A-K-A-D-E-M-I, and the Sahitya, the Sangeet Natak, Lalit Kala, all of these had been founded. The first exhibition of modern art had been inaugurated at the National Gallery, there were a great many institutions that came up. Artists were commissioned. The Reserve Bank of India buildings came up a little bit around that time. Nehru instituted the policy of reserving 2% of the cost of public works for art. So lots of these very positive things came up. And at the same time, the projection of India's identity at an international scale. This was taken over by Jawaharlal Nehru quite personally. And it was an era of cultural exchanges with Indian delegations traveling abroad. Musicians traveled abroad, and experts and technocrats of all kinds began swarming around the government. They were invited, and they were all around these places, in pretty much in this area where we are standing. And there was something of more than an openness, maybe even an urgency, to invite foreign ideas and professionals at the same time. By 1959, the same time, Corbusier had already been in India. He'd been in India to build and plan Chandigarh. But he'd been in India for some years, not just in Chandigarh. He'd already built stuff in the mill owners building, for example, and other buildings in Ahmedabad. Louis Kahn had been in Ahmedabad working on the Indian Institute of Management. And by then, both the Ford Foundation and the Rockefeller had taken a keen interest in India, and they'd recommended steps to regenerate the creative energy of the rural craftsmen and small industry via reports which were commissioned by Nehru in 1954 and 1957. These suggestions stressed that there was a need to preserve the purity of Indian art. But they also made suggestions about finance. They also made suggestions about marketing and indeed about design. But by then, in 1955, it was as a deputy of the Handicrafts Board that Pupul Jaikar visited America to participate in the Textile and Ornamental Arts of India exhibition at the MoMA. And the reason you see a line from Rockefeller paid for much of the MoMA exhibit. It was there that she met the designer and educator Charles Eames, who was already not a stranger to Indian craft. And he listened while Pupul Jaikar spoke to him about India and its craft ethos and the complex changes that were taking place, mainly negative changes. And since she had Nehru's ear, as she did of Indira and Rajiv Gandhi, the Eameses, Charles and Ray Eames, were chosen to recommend an agenda for craft and for design in India. So the Eames traveled in India for months, and they observed rural life, and they created the famous report called the India Report in about 1958. And this would become the philosophical kernel for the foundation of the National Institute of Design, henceforth affectionately known as NID, in 1961. And of course, perhaps the influence of the Sarabhais saw to it that that's where NID came up. Where else would you go? Ahmedabad was heavily on the map already because of the Sarabhais. And the other line that I think you might have seen is between the Ford Foundation and NID, which I think the Ford Foundation also helped finance the NID to some degree. This isn't the only institution that was founded in this period, but its influence has been very large. Influence has been the greatest, not only on design education, but perhaps on the life of design, if there is such a thing. Life of design in India, a bit like the life of Pi. This period illustrates, it illustrates the government's stance on design as an agent of development. And it sees seeing design's potential to re-energize industry and craft. This period transcends questions like Indian identity, deals with them in a number of ways, and goes ahead, goes much further than merely shaking off a colonial yoke. So there is, I think, very concerted action. And through the processes set in motion this decade and continued into later decades, I treat the period after 1961 separately, simply to facilitate a more detailed look at the impact of NID and some of the other institutes. So here we are in 1961. I'm a year old, and here is NID. Now, no institute of design in India is as admired, as debated, or as strongly denounced as the NID. It is these extreme reactions, and not any particular reaction, that is a reliable indicator of the impact that it has had. It was first set up as, it was actually a direct response of the government of India to the problems of small industries and set up following the EAMS report. Here's the EAMS report, and here's the great man and Ray Eames doing what they seem to do very often for the photographs, which is smiling. This report is quite a piece of work in that it meshed the concerns of Nehru with the earlier critics of industrialization, such as Tagore and Gandhi, who were all critics of kind of rampant or indiscriminate industrialization. It's not done in a stated way, but it's seems to be there. The report itself views India like a client, so it's this is not the Indian design report, it's the India report, and the Republic of India is the subject of inquiry, and it asks us to treat the village as a starting point, and it says discover an agenda of Indian design by looking at the village. It includes communication design in its ambit, which is not completely expected. It seeks a multidisciplinary approach. It embraces, wants to embrace sociology, engineering, economics, history, and the like. So these are the elements of what Eames calls an institute of design, research, and service. We shall see the role of the service part very shortly. And it addresses both rural crafts and the industrial enterprise. So in the decades that come, NID is fairly faithful to the Eames report. In other words, it does start out providing service, and Eames laid out the terms under which the service should be delivered, that in the government, he was concerned that NID should not be overrun by demands of service, and so he outlined where this service should and shouldn't be provided. Documents of national importance, wherever India's image overseas was at stake, and so on. And what we see is the government becoming NID's biggest client for design. And a great many logos over the years, familiar logos for government and arms of government, it follows the Eames's recommendations, and the job of providing services, once it finds its feet by the middle 60s, it's taking some time to set up, and then it finds its feet and does exactly that. And the projects range from identities and important publications, which were of critical importance, pretty much as Eames had envisaged. Here's one that some of you may remember, those of you of a certain age. Here's someone I think everybody will remember. And here are some more. So that's the Airports Authority over there. That's Operation Flood. There's the Trade Fair Authority, CMC. Now, the NID doesn't simply do identity, so it also does very serious-minded things like forms for the Census of India. And it's with the kind of discourse that the NID started that the idea of function became center stage in design, that you started from, you could start from a functional point of view, it was okay to do so. And this is different from the definition of design the previous century, where the function of an object was taken for granted and your job as a designer was to make it more pleasing or better crafted or a better reminder of what our civilization could be. Not too many people know that the EVM, the electronic voting machine, is also an NID project. But the projects that best typify what Eames had in mind for the NID are what are called the crafts interventions. They tended to be called interventions. I think you heard Suchitra use the word interventions at a couple of times. And those interventions took the shape of identifying a cluster of craftsmen and assessing their economic status, assessing their skills, assessing what they were capable of and not. much of this part of the lecture is drawn from the writings and my conversations with M.P. Ranjan, a great educator who's been a student and a teacher at NID for, 40 years or something. The idea was that after assessing the conditions, it would define a goal. Often this is called a business model. And the idea of a business model for a community was that to find a way, for example, for it to become self-sufficient. And they saw themselves as creating strategies for these communities. For example, here it says strategy product diversification. So this is in Jawaja, where both leatherwork and weaving used to take place, and it was defined by a very desperate case by the Indian government, and this is in the end this would result in a designed object. So maybe an NID student or a team or a faculty would eventually co-create. So the idea was that you worked with rural craftsmen and you worked, you helped them improve their designs or make them more saleable. Very recognizable object there at top right. I'll show you a bigger picture. Extremely recognizable bag if you lived in India in, say, the 1980s. I'm sure many such bags have passed through this building. Indeed, toting this bag in the 1980s marked you out as a certain kind of person. It gave you a certain cachet among those who knew. An example of the kind of weaving. Now, the promise of this approach is that it encourages us to look beyond design as a thing, as a noun, and it encourages you to look at design as creating an altered set of circumstances. And this is not, in a way, so different from what we do today as commercial designers. But it creating an altered set of conditions, for example, one that makes a village craft community self-sufficient. Now, conceiving this intervention in this way from the start becomes the object of the design thinking behind the project. And the design product now becomes a means to this. So this is design as action, you know, aiming at as a societal or economic outcome and not simply the product. It's in the area of textiles, actually, that NID designers filled a growing demand for designers. So the textile industry was also booming at the time in Gujarat and beyond. And of the disciplines taught at NID, there was a discipline called textile design. This was the first to very easily and quickly fit into the industrial ecosystem and start becoming productive in a much more mainstream, if you like, in a mainstream sense. The extremely socially driven or development agenda is also seen in communications, and this is the work of the Udaipur-based Vikalp Design, which describes itself as a social communication outfit. And this is a wheel that turns to various positions and illustrates, guess what, a cycle. And Vikalp also claims to do research where they study problems like what rural audiences really understand and what they don't, in contrast to urban audiences. So this is the flavor of their work, and it's an example of the same kind of thinking most seen in the 1970s, still out there. Focusing on India and focusing on extreme relevance to Indian conditions, this is a look at quite a cool looking bicycle. This was designed by the designer S. Balram while he was at the Royal College of Art. But for the most part, you would find that NID graduates tended to join industries and do the regular sort of things that you or I would recognize. The other strand in NID was that in the early years and to an extent later, NID sent its faculty abroad to study, and they allowed them to spend time, significant amounts of time, abroad at various centers of design and soak in whatever there was to soak in. And a great number of renowned designers also visited NID on training. And here we see a very famous designer of typefaces, Adrian Frutiger, delivering a riff on his take on Gujarati while all kinds of interested people are looking on. So the first batches were trained here and trained in a way like this, and these became the pillars of the faculty for the coming decades. One of them is Mahendra Patel. So Adrian Frutiger and Mahendra Patel had a great partnership, and here is Devanagari for airport signage as developed by Mahendra Patel. And you can see here the effort to turn these forms into very distilled, very simplified forms. I'm going to show you another image, and that is Mahendra Patel's proposal for a multilingual kind of system in several languages with the intention of matching the typeface that you see in English, which is Neuer Frutiger. Now, this is part of an international trend that was also in kind of in vogue at the time, that the popular Latin sans serif typefaces were matched by Asian scripts, for example. So you could find this in Hebrew, or you could find this in other Asian scripts as well. It growing out of this, the influence of the Swiss design schools, particularly the one at Basel, and also to some extent Ulm in Germany, a certain kind of modernism forms a second strand of NID, especially Swiss modernism. And that stresses a distillation of form into what I can best describe as geometric primitives, to distill and pare things down to their essentials. And in typography, it recommended a very rational approach to typography with a great respect for sizes and not that much respect for, let's say, the variety of typefaces that existed. There's also promoted a sort of universalism. So there was actually in Switzerland, an industrial consensus on what constituted good form, and the notion that good form was universal, and that if it was really good, it would be universal. And if it wasn't universal, maybe it wasn't good enough. There is even a quote by Eames to the same effect. So good form was universal, and if it was universal, it was probably good form as well. These are two ways of thinking about the problem, and I personally have been very influenced by, it's a very influential point of view. I've been influenced by it, and I'm equally influenced by the opposite point of view. But one of the designers at NID worth noting is, if you look at these chairs, so they are very much a product of this kind of thinking, very influential pedagogy. So the teaching methods focused on things like, you start with a dot, and a dot extends to become a line, and a line becomes a plane, and a plane becomes a cube, and so on. Gajanan Upadhyay at NID he spent actually two stints at NID, with a long stint in the middle where he worked in Sweden, if I recall, Denmark was it, and he trained in this kind of way of thinking about furniture, and often produced exquisitely detailed, very, very beautiful furniture. I'm going to show you a few slides from a monograph that NID brought out. So this is the cafeteria chair. It was produced in several models, a stackable kind, a non-stackable, non-foldable, stackable but not foldable, foldable but not stackable, both foldable and stackable. all kinds of chairs were produced. This kind. So that's from the monograph of Gajanan Upadhyay. Here's a book cover that says a lot to me about the NID. It's for the first thing, if I describe this picture, I find a lot in it that says that describes NID for me. You can see the influence of, you know, the right-ranging typography, the choice of that particular typeface, the use of white space, all aligned to the right, very, very Swiss. The craft object, which easily points to NID's interest in that area, and the fact that this is an NID publication, it's a document, and documentation is something in which has been very important at NID, and NID has played a huge role in documenting crafts, in documenting industries like bamboo and cane. So I spoke about MP Ranjan earlier, and he's one of those who's kind of a, what should I say, himself a great big clump of bamboo, if you like, in that field for 40 years. And here's a very contemporary use of bamboo by a student quite recently, now running a studio of his own. So in the meantime, outside NID, by the 1980s, the IITs had also set up design departments, like the Industrial Design Center, headed by Sudhakar Nadkarni. The faculty, as with NID, went abroad to study at places like Royal College of Art, but their engineering focus still dominates. So even so, by the 1990s, several had graphic design departments. JJ had a commercial art department from 1946, where it became a separate institute by 1961. It continues to feed advertising and design with supply of top-class talent, and one of its famous alumni, R.K. Joshi, designed this logo for the ITC, the Welcome Hotels at the time, and several important identities. Here's one for SAIL, and here's one for the Punjab Bank. It's interesting to contrast this with the State Bank of India logo. So you can see two quite different approaches to the problem of branding a bank. Joshi's attempt on the right is very much based on a love of Indian scripts, the way in which the per character ambiguates between Devanagari and Gurmukhi forms. Sudarshan Dheer, not an JJ alum, produced these and tens of other important logos. By about the 1980s, type had become digital, and a slew of organizations rushed to create digital type. A lot of this action was centered in Devanagari. A lot of it was centered around Pune, and it was embraced, you know, since government was going to computerize its operations. But in here, you were more likely to find IDC Powai graduates rather than NID ones, despite Mahendra Patel's, you know, quite early start down this line, in part because of IDC's engineering focus, and maybe because of the presence of R.K. Joshi himself, who was a type designer who designed the first Devanagari fonts for Microsoft. This one is a ubiquitous font. You've seen it everywhere. It's called Yogesh. I haven't been able to find the name of the designer, but it emerged from CDAC, a government organization. And it wasn't intended to match Helvetica. I've just made this picture just as a suggestion of the sort of effort it is. It's really, really commonplace, and it is in a sense like the Helvetica in the sense of its ubiquity. Or if in India, maybe we should say it's the ubiquitous font is Arial, but that's another story. So I want to talk next about returning to Delhi. And I want to talk about the forces that led to the creation of NID and how they activated ripples of change in Delhi. And that's where I observed it, which are difficult to summarize, but easy to sense if you had lived through the Delhi of the 70s, as I did. These forces were driven, remember that these same forces were driven by two elites. So there was an existing social elite and a design elite. It had just been created. And the place where we are standing is very much, all the action that we are talking about is probably took place within kind of a 5 mile radius or 5 kilometer radius of here, this very place. So in the 60s and 70s, a sort of style revolution overran the homes of the, you know, the tonier upper class, upper middle class intelligentsia. It became fashionable, even virtuous, to kind of nonchalantly throw together Western design with Indian art objects and also Indian design. The HHEC, Handloom and Handicrafts Operation, the Cottage Industries Emporium, they launched in the 1950s, in the Pupul Jaikar days, fed this revolution. And it's instructive for me to look at two businesses who are part of this story. And I think they are milestones in the development of the appetite for design in those decades. So what you see here is a tall man standing on a chair. And the tall man is John Bissell, who founded the first of these companies, Fab India, in 1960, just around when NID started. Fab India worked with local weavers to make their work ready for foreign and then Indian markets. Started as an export-oriented organization, but it also employed designers to work on new products using traditional techniques. One of these was Ritain Mazumdar, a versatile designer whose bed linen we see here. This line in became a blockbuster hit at Fab India. And in fact, this collection was shown at the Jahangir Art Gallery in 1978. This is the poster, also, I think, designed by him. And the exhibition was a completely sold out. Now, the bed in this picture and the chair on which John Bissell is standing are by another business I consider iconic of that time. And it was called Taru. It was founded by Minnie Boga in about 1967. Minnie Boga is here somewhere. Taru employed designers too, and very much in the style of a Western organization, paid royalties, licensed designs. Ritain Mazumdar was also one of the designs, but one of the designers. But Taru's most successful line was probably by Ravi Sikri, an architect. Here it is. The woven back with, you know, the kind of charpai material, or indeed done in Newar, typifies the most successful, most iconic Taru look and encapsulates the aesthetic attitude that took hold at the time. Now, both of these were founded by design entrepreneurs who were inspired by design as business. These ideas are not too far from what NID would do later in the 70s, except that these businesses directly intervened in the market space. Fab India runs a social enterprise for profit, but it's structured as a suppliers cooperative. So it runs a very unusual structure. And Taru was run like a regular business. Neither was driven purely by profit, so I believe. Importantly, both employed designers, paid royalties and license fees. Taru licensed designs from NID as well, some of Gajanan Upadhyay's work. And Fab India have created a John Bissell chair at NID and indeed employs many graduates. So this story of this time is about the building of capability and institutions and the creation of a great confidence in a sort of Indian design identity, with both government and private individuals playing huge roles. The relative decline of the importance of government and a question about whether this confidence was sustained is the subject of the years after 1991, which has brought very sweeping changes. Now, it's been the central thesis behind my talk that design's trajectory responds most to the economic environment in ways good and bad. Its opening up after 1991 seems to have had the effect of proliferating everything. Design schools, graduates, firms, designers, beauty, sophistication, crassness, and created squalor. We see a consolidation of the role of government, but we don't see a corresponding energy or pace of development. like we did in the 60s. Even though the government now recognizes design as a competitive force and has thus instituted a national design policy, there is an Indian Design Council, there is an Indian Design Mark. The design mark is a design certification. It follows similar efforts in Germany and Japan. Whether it's going to have market power is to be seen. The other significant institute that opened up after the NIDs and NIITs is, of course, NIFT, the Fashion Technology Institute, behind which we also see the hand of Pupul Jaikar. Its graduates made an instant mark, and some of them have started to make waves internationally. In the 1990s, at least 8 new private institutes opened, expanding the design workforce, mainly in graphic design. NID graduate now appears as a desirable tag in matrimonial classifieds. So my chair tells me. And she is an authoritative person, you have to believe her. Design is now better understood. I don't anymore face the question, what exactly do you do? I don't face that question anymore. There will soon be 4 more NIDs. NID old timers complain of expansion without a plan, and they speak of dilution. It's a little like the debates on the IITs, which have been proceeding on similar lines. On the other hand, in every initiative in the crafts or the development sector where design can play a role, you are likely to see NID students. Several institutes of craft have been started by its alumni teachers in, say, UP or Kashmir or Jaipur. I'm going to leave you with this montage. That's it. You're done. Thanks.